story you are about to hear is true. Only the names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Fatima Cigarettes, best of all long cigarettes, brings you...
Holy Fuck Web News Episode 1. Motherfucker.
When you've got the kind of shit you've got going on these days. Cops killing people because they feel like it, because they had a bad fucking day. Anyways, this first episode will focus on the only thing worth talking about in the end of April, beginning of May 2015, the death of Freddie Gray, and the ensuing backlash.
Sorry about all the bulls, but all the stuff, but the prosecutor is he's an effing bad guy, and he's pissing me off.
He can't even speak without swearing. Your Honor, this is ludicrous. It's a disgrace to these proceedings.
I'm the police when I take for the underclass. Get the face, name and number on the badge. They flash, we flash back when they act disorderly. React accordingly and capture all that we see. Nightstick, zip ties and tasers. Think your license for tight vicious behavior. Make a tight miss with the video trends. Or the pig like this, he dripping, you make him blame us. Explain to a judge the bounds you overstepping. 2011, time to change our method. We aiming lenses like the state's weapon. Today remember whose goddamn streets they're protecting. Yeah, they rather see me in a cell than me in my cell with a different story to tell. Can't pull up out of dash next time you get stopped. Reach for the cellar if you wanna shoot a cop on the public sidewalk. You could take what you see or film from your window with the view of the street. Neighborhood crime watch, we police the police. Uh-uh. They can't arrest the whole community.
Fuck you, pig!
Some of these protesters who were used to doing this, sir, would you like to say something that's now been taken into custody?
I feel I'm being arrested unjustly. This is my city. These police don't live here. I do. You know, I think I'm being arrested for standing out here for justice for Freddie Gray and for all the residents of the black community who are harassed daily by the police here.
They've arrested you for violating the curfew.
The curfew is bullshit. Pardon my French.
Want to excuse that language there?
Hey, U.S. out of Baltimore. We're under military occupation right now. U.S. out of Baltimore.
Greetings, peasants. I'm Paul.
And I'm Isaac.
And this is the Holy Fuck Web News inaugural episode number one. We started this podcast, well, not gonna lie, we were gonna start it anyway eventually, but we kinda got motivated when this dude named Freddie Gray in Isaac's hometown, what I consider my hometown of Baltimore, got fucking straight beat to death by the police in West Baltimore for, as far as we can tell, for making eye contact.
Only crime was running from the police.
Since it's been a few days, and since most of you guys aren't going to actually hear this episode for some months to come, Isaac wanted to go ahead and give a historical rundown of what happened to Freddie Gray, and then kind of what happened to Baltimore as a result.
Sure. Well, Freddie Gray was arrested on Sunday, April 12th, in his neighborhood of Sandtown, Winchester. He lived in a public housing project called Gilmore Homes. where police reportedly made eye contact with him, and he then turned and turned and ran and was chased. And the police took him down brutally, and one of them slammed his knee into the back of his neck, and they dragged him into a paddy wagon and took him away. And, hey, where'd your video go?
Fuck the video.
Okay. So, where was I? Oh, yeah. It's come out in the ensuing investigation that the van made an unscheduled stop, where they picked up another passenger, and, half an hour later, when they arrived at the police station, Freddie Gray was dead, or wasn't dead. He was still alive, but he had slipped into cardiac arrest, and his spine was severed and his larynx crushed, and he died in a coma 7 days later on Sunday the 19th, and that's when Baltimore really erupted and the protests began. In Sandtown, Winchester, at the corner where he was killed, Mountain Fesbury.
So I wasn't there. I live in Arkansas. So tell me, who were the people who decided that this particular, murder was the one that was going to make them stand up? Police in Baltimore, of all places, they murder people every week or every month minimum. Who was it, and what do you think was significant about Freddie Gray? It was filmed? Wasn't that it?
I think part of it was is an accident of history. Honestly, I think that he was. He died at the right moment to spark something when everything was set to explode already, and tensions were running at an all-time high between black people in West Baltimore and all over the U.S. and the police. Part of the inauguration of that new era has certainly been that people all carry portable cameras in their cell phones in their pockets. Can document the police doing what they've always done. I mean, every 28 hours in this country, a black man is killed by the police. That's their function. They terrorize the black community.
Well, so it must be more often that someone is killed by the police. I obviously agree that blacks are targeted. Yeah, no, I agree with that. But what I'd like to know is, I think it's more of the state versus the people.
The poor, yeah. I mean, one thing I think is definitely true that I've heard is that the police treat black people in the U.S. the way they treat poor people everywhere,
Right,
their function is to control a surplus population and prevent, a surplus labor force and prevent some rise job.
But it's also, when no one's looking, they do the same to whites. You and I know that.
Oh, absolutely. I've been targeted by police, and I've been, I've been the target of police violence before many times.
Didn't you just collect a check from it?
I just collected a check for $3,000 from
Pasco.
The police department.
Collect $3,000. Do not go to jail.
$3,000.
Do not go to jail.
Do not go to jail.
And that was from years ago, folks.
That was from 3 years ago in Oakland, during Occupy Oakland, when the OPP beat me up. Me and 359 other people outside the YMCA. But
I lived there in 2012, they still thought Occupy was going on. they still did Chocupy, and there was still a lot of home bums that claimed Occupy all day. But it was just a good place to pick up weed, really. See, I'm a target. When I got here to Hot Springs, dude, literally the first four times I walked out of the house, the three of them I was arrested. No shit. It was the same cop every time, and it was just bullshit charges.
Yeah, but
Anyhow,
I mean, I do think it's worth noting in this podcast that, you know, that the first American police are direct descendants of the slave patrols of the 1600s and 1700s. You know, those same bodies evolved into the first police forces in this country. And it's remarkable how little their role has changed, you know. Yeah, like you said, America's a racist-ass country. It's, you know, founded on these people's stolen labor. And
But when you get down to it...
And part of the function of the state, you know, has always been to repress those people. And I think, you know, the prison system is still set up for it.
I don't know. I have two conflicting thoughts, you know, and one is that, you know, I guess it's true. Like, if you go to a place like Seattle on a normal day where it's mostly white people,
right,
and you deal with a cop there, he's all friendly. Same thing in Denver, parts of Denver. I think, you know, you get that vibe that you can approach a cop if you really want to and ask him the time or something.
You certainly can't do that in a poor neighborhood anywhere.
You know, I was 18 years old the first time I was arrested. I was arrested 2 weeks after I had supposedly committed a crime. and I had, you know, anarchistic beliefs. But I just...
Anarchistic tendencies.
And I was really... It never hit me until that moment. Like, these motherfuckers really are in charge, you know, and it doesn't make any sense. Like, this guy is as dumb as a brick. Back to the story of Freddie Gray.
He dies on April 19th in the protest breakout at Mount Street in Presbury in Southtown Winchester, the spot where I believe his neck was broken when he was arrested. And they, you know, the neighborhood rose up spontaneously, and there were demonstrations every night starting at 5 p.m. They famously swarmed a CNN news camera on the first night and yelled "fuck CNN" into it. And then that continued for about a week, culminating in, you know, and then during that week, a local pastor from West Baltimore named Reverend Wesley West led people downtown on Tuesday, and the protest got its first real, like, media exposure then. But it wasn't until Saturday, April 25th, that the wind really shifted here in Baltimore. It's when there were two demonstrations called, one by the People's Power Assembly and one by Malik Shabazz from Black Lawyers for Justice, formerly of the new Black Panther Party, who showed up in Baltimore to lead a protest and was decried as an outside agitator. And a group marched around Gilmore Homes, where Freddie Gray was from, and picked up supporters, and then marched downtown and got to City Hall. And Chavez spoke, and after he spoke, the youth of Gilmore Homes and some Bloods and Crips and a few white anarchists branched off and charged, Camden Yards, and met where this baseball game taking place.
And charged Camden Yards? Weren't they just marching? Or I thought Camden Yards charged them from the videos I saw.
Well, I mean, we definitely took off running on Conway Street, you know, and then upon reaching the police line, you know, people were throwing trash cans and aluminum barricades and attacking the police there, and then we retreated and over onto Howard Street, and where there was another confrontation, and the cops did attack us, and charged batons. They destroyed the reinforced banner we had brought that day, and pushed us back up north towards Pratt Street, where I and some other people were pepper sprayed. They were definitely targeting black people in that crowd too. The guy next to me got the brunt of the pepper spray, and I only got, you know, a little bit in my right eye. But people were fighting back, you know, and when we were eventually pushed up to the corner of Howard and Pratt, there were four cop cars destroyed by angry youth from the neighborhood, and one of them, an 18-year-old man named Alan Bullock, who turned himself in at the urging of his mother, is being held at $500,000 bail now and facing life in prison for destroying four police cars. That bail is higher than the bail of any of the six murdering cops who killed Freddie Gray and were arrested on Friday, May 1st, May Day, only because of the massive display of resistance in the streets on Saturday the 25th and Monday the 27th, and really for 2 weeks straight through. You know, it takes an act of God to get for a cop to get charged.
Sure. Well, it wasn't an act of God. It was an act of the people. No matter who they are, anytime we're talking about this, I say to them, look, this is the sad reality. If you're a believer in your system and whatnot, why the fuck does it take all that to get justice? I mean, we're not even talking about convictions here yet. We're just saying we want to see these motherfuckers brought to justice. You know, in Ferguson, we had similar things going on. And I think the city of Baltimore learned from St. Louis because, you know, 4 months of nonstop demonstrations, you know, it cost them a lot of money and a lot of, bad press, and got the federal government looking into them and all this shit. So Baltimore, they were like, fuck no, we're gonna have these motherfuckers, you know, we're gonna have the grand jury go through within a fucking week. You know, we're not gonna, but here's the thing, like, if you believe in the system, if you're listening to this and you believe that police and government and all this stuff is necessary, ask yourself, why does it take what you call riots to get officers of the law to answer for breaking the law? Which, you know, that's what murder is. And when a police officer does it, it's different because it has to be unjustified. But by all accounts, including the video evidence that really set this off that we haven't even mentioned, including, you know, eyewitness accounts, even including the statements of the officers, this man was not posing a threat to them in any way. In any case, that's another thing.
No crime.
And that's another thing you need to question is, why is there ever six police necessary? I mean, that's a lot of wasted money. Six cops on duty for 1 hour, that cost $1,000. $1,000 all told, minimum. I mean, I'm just ballparking it. You know, that's money that could go to something far more useful.
Some journalist recently released an interesting statement that all of the money spent on arresting and processing Freddie Gray throughout his 25-year life, through all the times he was stopped by the police, added up to more money than would have been necessary to put him through college.
The state
literally paid to harass him for his entire life rather than put him through college.
And I'm sure I bet I have a figure something around that. I've been arrested 37 times.
And oh, you have a figure way more than that. I think Freddie had like 18 or something.
I've been arrested many times. I've been more than double. I've been a hassle about it. I've spent money.
You could have gone to college twice on your
on how much it cost them. Well, it all depends on how much they're spending, doesn't it? But you can't really talk about these protests and not talk about the ridiculousness of the state as an institution. I mean, nobody's asking the right questions. Like, what were those cops doing there? I personally believe that if you're gonna have police, they should be a reactionary force. They should only show up when duty calls. You know, like, there's a fucking reason they're there. I don't believe in patrols. I see that as terrorism. I mean,
because of the decades of institutional neglect, racialized blockbusting, and white flight out of fucking Sandtown Winchester, like, it's a drug neighborhood, you know. And the state's reaction to this is not to address the problems of the neighborhood. It's to send in, you know, a militarized occupying police force to constantly monitor and harass people. That is their job. They're, you know, you call them terrorists. That's exactly what they do. They're an institution that practices terror systematically.
Right.
On groups of people that have been labeled insurgents. Well, you know.
So I don't know what I wanted to
If you call somebody an insurgent, sometimes they start acting like it, I think is what...
I mean, I witnessed the murder. Like, within 6 months of moving to Baltimore, I witnessed a murder on that bridge, one of those bridges over behind that building I lived on St. Paul.
Really? And then I've only ever seen one ever on Northern Parkway.
And then I saw another one when I was living on West North Avenue while you were living in L.A. I saw a triple murder. But the one that I saw on the bridge, like, I was probably 200 yards back. And this struck me. This is what struck me about it. I was, like, 200 yards back in a Cadillac, like, drives into the person up against the fucking side of the bridge. And then they get out and shoot him to death. And then they drive away and their car's all damaged and whatever. And I turned around and went to the next bridge to cross or to get over or whatever. I don't know, but I know that I saw that shit and I was just like, why not me though? I was like a witness, and that's what clicked, is like, no matter one way or another, that person was like a problem to them that they couldn't go to the system to solve. And you know, that's what it comes down to, is like this so-called riot, these demonstrations, this frustration of the people.
I mean, I will say that the only night of the out of the 16 days of protest that followed Freddie Gray's death, before, you know, I suppose on Tuesday there was finally a calm day in which nothing happened, unfortunately. But in all of the 16 days of protest, the only day that the demonstrators themselves referred to as a riot was Monday the 27th. Monday, April 27th. Because, That was the day that the overwhelming majority of the looting and vehicle fires occurred. But it was instigated by the police themselves, too. Property destruction and self-defense against the police, and even a little bit of looting and expropriation of goods had already occurred on Saturday downtown. But on Monday, the police preemptively shut down the buses and the metro at Mondawmin Mall. And a crowd of angry teenagers could not get home, were kettled in, were attacked by the police, and fought back. And at one point, the hail of rocks that they generated pushed the police into retreat. People were singing, "They know better, they know better, no cop zone, no cop zone," as people retreated, and as the cops retreated, it was awesome. The cops were fucking picking up rocks and throwing them back at people. That's when people began invading Mondawmin Mall and expropriating goods for themselves. And I saw a lot of people leaving with like armfuls of toilet paper and toiletries and Tide and, you know, diapers and stuff like that. And it wasn't until later that the CVS famously got looted and burned at the corner of Penn North, which later became colloquially referred to as Ground Zero by the residents of the neighborhood.
That was that CVS.
Okay.
Yeah, I used to go there often. I bought a lot of shit there. I used to live 3 blocks from Penn North, as you know. But anyway, right across from there, ironically, right across from CVS is the social services office. Little publicized fact. Did they get attacked?
I don't think so.
You know, and go figure. You know, I'm sure if there was a police station located right across, it might have spilled over. But somehow the people decided that, you know, these people that were not assholes to them their entire lives. This is the kind of shit the cops will do in West Baltimore. You know, on a Monday night, you will hear a cop siren at 2 in the morning when everything else is quiet. Even the old dude across the street has stopped playing his fucking R&B at top volume. Fucking, I mean, outside playing at a top volume until like midnight or whatever. But even after he's going to sleep, you hear the cops at a fucking, like, this muted siren, just so that it's just loud enough to wake anybody up all night fucking long. And they just go through the neighborhoods just like that, just to fucking fuck with people. And I remember one time, me and D'Amica, this is when I lived on Harlem Avenue. Me and D'Amica and one other person that lived in that house were just sitting on the porch, and like a whole shit ton of cops went to this place up the street, which we didn't even know anybody there. And they fucking came down there and told us to go inside. And we were like, why? And they were like, go inside or you're going to jail too. Like, we were like, what the fuck? And that's the kind of shit cops do in Baltimore. And that was 10 years ago almost. Shit.
It's some Gestapo shit. Very little has changed. If anything, it's intensified in response to people's resistance, to people's challenging their authority to do so. You know? And so if I could just say something a little bit about the word riot, though, and why I think it's important to refer to these events as a protest, or even an uprising, as some people have begun to do. It's that, you know, that there's, as you said the last time we recorded, there's, you know, that there's a huge disparity in how there's a major difference in the way the media treat events in the U.S. and other countries. Like, if this had happened, you know, if demonstrated it,
this wouldn't even make the news. If this
happened in Egypt, or Tunisia, or fucking Ukraine. You know, it's they're courageous, but if they do it in West Baltimore, they're thugs, you know.
Right.
Which is essentially just a code word for black. And there was an extensive media operation that accompanied the protests and the Monday night riot that, you know, in which they tried everything. Like Jack Young had a press conference at city council with two alleged gang leaders. And they brought in Ray Lewis, formerly of the Baltimore Ravens, and a former.
No one gives a fuck what you got to say.
Yeah, they brought him in to be like the moral arbiter of a city, and nobody in the streets gave a fuck. It was great. And they and Hillary Clinton cried, and all of the. Like, some celebrities declared their support for the protests, which was cool, but I don't remember. But honestly,
I think a lot of celebrities were saying that they just didn't. Jon Stewart was one, you know. Yeah. He did a pretty funny thing on The Daily Show where he like ran. He was talking about it from the beginning, and he was like, "Wait, no, that's the footage of the football riots," and like talk, you know, like. No, that's the footage of when they won. No, that's the foot. No, wrong footage. Like, just kept fucking with it. Like,
yeah.
You know, he's just like, he was very upset at the media and the way they covered it. You know, speaking of the media, there was the incident with Geraldo Rivera, which, you know, since you're listening to this, you know, months or years from now on the internet, Google that shit. Like, Geraldo Rivera getting told by a random hood person. I mean, in a very respectful.
Yeah, that guy was awesome.
Guy had a lot of self-respect, because I think most people in the same shoes, dealing with the same piece of shit, would have gone a little more, fuck you style. But, you know, this guy,
I just called him Jerry Rivers when I saw him. That's his real fucking name.
Right. And so it is. And, Damn. So... what have we not mentioned yet?
Well,
as far as this goes, I mean, this is something, you know, is very well covered. Not as well covered as.
Well, on Friday, May 1st, I mean, there was the whole curfew, I guess. Governor Hogan called in the National Guard.
Yeah, that was interesting.
And they instituted a 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. curfew every night from Tuesday night onward. We were essentially under martial law because. My God, if the governor has to get on TV and explain painstakingly why it's not martial law, then it's martial law. But the National Guard sucked. They were, you know, they were less active than the police. They were just there to protect the property generally, while the police made arrests to attack people.
I was in the army. They have very specific shit that they can react to. They weren't there to police. They were there to, it seemed like to protect government buildings.
That's right.
Which is kind of their purpose, you know, to make sure that the government didn't get burned down or whatever. And, you know, that's to be said to their credit that they didn't somehow get involved. Because, I mean, there's always stories of when the National Guard and Army went into Katrina, how they were shooting looters and shit like that.
I mean, they were definitely involved. They were in the streets patrolling them with armored vehicles, you know, don't get me wrong. But most of the clashes, I suppose, took place between protesters and city police, county police.
So I mean, and I mean that's what you expect a fucking National Guard. I mean they're douchebags through and through.
So protesters went out to defy the curfew every night on on Wednesday night or
which
Thursday
this curfew
night.
Has no legal standing. Has no legal standing.
Right. It was just an emergency measure they put in place to stop the rebellion.
It's but, like if they stopped.
I went out
one
of the. I went out in the second or third night of the curfew and fucking at Penn North, and there was a surreal scene where it was a crowd of mostly police and media, with a tiny minority of protesters, and an overwhelming crowd of police and media.
Don't forget what ended the curfew. Some white folks in Hamden.
Well, what ended the curfew was a lot of things.
But I mean, in the media's
eyes.
What ended
was a lot of things. There was a demonstration in Hamden that white people called to, to make a point, to show how much more gently they would be treated than black people doing the exact same thing at Penn North and Sandtown Winchester. But I think there was also an outcry by the service industry and restaurant industries, over lost business because of the curfew, and the jails were also just filling up as people continued to violate it. So I think both direct action by people getting arrested and refusing to respect the curfew, and and defying it graciously was a factor. And I think the local
in Oakland when they jailed us for speaking our minds,
bourgeoisie was a factor too.
In Oakland, when they jailed us for speaking our minds, we filled up their jails and shat on their walls. I don't remember until they had to change their policy.
Yeah.
I mean, as anti-statists, you and I are both very jaded. We're never going to sit back and call victory, there's still people that think Occupy wasn't a sham.
Right, but there was a victory rally on, I guess it was Saturday, May 2nd.
Leave it to the left, man.
Malik Shabazz called for this victory rally, and they, because the six cops were convicted, and after that, it's when shit really died down. And people stopped coming out in the streets. And I think the state, and then 10:30 a.m. on Sunday morning, the curfew was lifted. Stephanie Rawlings played for the curfew. So, as I said, in response to overwhelming popular pressure from both.
Well, one positive that, from my perspective, one positive that did come out of it is that we basically know that the tolerance of that city in particular is pretty low. In terms, I mean.
Well, I think we, we kind
what
of.
What I mean is that they can, what they can respond to, because when Rawlings Blake went on TV and said, let them express their anger or whatever, that wasn't like the fucking,
counter revolutionaries.
Like,
right.
Right. That wasn't the counter revolutionaries like paying her off to do that. That was like her admitting, tactically that she didn't have the resources to put down the rebellion,
right.
Like, she didn't.
Well, she said that on Saturday night, and the night is Saturday, April 25th. It didn't really, really pop off until Monday the 27th, two days later. But, Saturday was what a friend of mine called the pre-cum riot. And then Monday was the, real thing.
Well, so conspiracy time. We'll always have a conspiracy time. And later on, we'll have these really rad sound effects of like conspiracy time. So, I don't know, man. Like, do you think it's kind of like another test?
I think the police definitely instigated the Monday night riot at Mondawmin. In order for Hogan to have an excuse to call him the National Guard. I think that much.
I think that was orchestrated.
That much, I think we can assume. honestly, it was... I think the movement was getting too scrappy and too rebellious, so they nipped it in the bud by setting it off. And that they set off a riot and they quarantined it in West Baltimore in areas that are, that looked like a bomb went off in them anyway and are still devastated from the 1968 riots. They tried to pen it off in an area of the city that nobody cared about. But people had, you know, people had a lot of clout. And people, you know, people
so
fought back.
Think...
And the riots eventually, you know, the protests and looting spilled out of West Baltimore and eventually got as far as Fells Point and East Baltimore, where they famously burned the construction site of a proposed senior housing facility, which looked really bad, but, you know, I think...
Yeah, what kind of seniors?
Part of the point... Right, part of the point was that you can't... You know, right, exactly.
I think that the issue with East Baltimore is that they have succeeded in gentrifying it, you know, east of Hopkins, and that's what
sure.
they're... That's certainly the project... You know, they're expanding. It's becoming like a northeast and middle north.
Oh, well, this is more around Johns Hopkins Hospital than Broadway East.
Right. But, you know, the economic warfare has definitely gone a lot further over there. So it's no surprise sure. that the people who still live there are ready to, when they see an opportunity, are ready to tear some shit up.
A lot of pharmacies got looted, too. I saw a definite shift in the kind of goods that people were expropriating on that night in West Baltimore from, you know, which was largely household items and toiletries and things people needed to survive that they couldn't afford to the rest of the city, where it became increasingly only pharmacies, which were hit for drugs. And I think people were leaving West Baltimore and escaping through the police lines and finding their way out in cars and, hitting pharmacies throughout the day. That was one thing about it that was kind of remarkable, was that it was undoubtedly like a West Baltimore riot, you know. like people, like, at no point did the hustling ever stop, no matter how heated the street fighting got. You know, people kept right on selling drugs. People were busting out of the CVS with Percocets and selling them immediately. I saw a kid, probably a minor, lob a brick at a passing cop car, and then without missing a beat, turn around and look at me and say, "Yo, I got ready.
Maybe he just thought he was about to go to jail, so he's like, I better get rid of this shit and have some money in my pocket.
Yeah, could have been. Or maybe he's just been doing that to every white person
he's ever seen
in West Baltimore, you know?
Yeah.
He's probably like 14 years old.
Yeah, that was a definite part of your day. As a white person who lived in West Baltimore, you would walk home from work. It was a long walk, because I worked in East Baltimore. It was a long, interesting walk, and, you know, at least
well,
7 times.
You live
times.
Under such an apartheid system in the city that your presence is an event, you know?
Yeah, for the first, I guess, month, 2 months tops. And then it's like, I start to become the person saying to others, like, hey, maybe that's a customer. You know, you know, but, I mean, I guess I don't want to go on this long-winded talk about drug dealing or whatever, but pretty much what people don't realize is, like, yeah, you can make a lot of money selling drugs, say you get away with it for 6 months, and at least 4 of those months' wages will end up going to the state when the time you're arrested 6 months in. You know, like, you have to be extremely skillful to actually retain what you make doing that. Without the taxes on drug dealing are over 100%. That's what I'm getting at.
Right.
So, you know, to make a phone call from jail, for instance, costs $2.50 a minute. To call the same area code.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, when I got locked up in September, we ended up spending like $400 in calls. It's kind of outrageous. So, anyhow, what do you think needs to come out of this? I mean, clearly, you know, a lot of people seem to be satisfied with the one officer getting charged with second degree murder and the other five getting involuntary manslaughter, which is more really than I think a lot of us expected, actually.
Absolutely. I think the fact that the cops have been charged at all is nothing short of a miracle, and it just really shows the remarkable strength of the people that have come together to fight with Freddie Gray. But I think that I don't think this is over. I think that not if, but when those cops are found not guilty and set free, and those murdering pigs walk, that the city will explode once again.
Okay, suppose it goes the other way.
Over. Penn North is—I don't know.
These are not appropriate charges. If six black men beat a white man to death, it would be first degree murder for all six of them.
I think movements like this have an ebb and flow to them that, you know, that sometimes you just kind of have to roll with. It's not over. Penn North has never been this clean. It looks amazing. The atmosphere is still electric. Like, people, strangers greet each other on the street by saying, fuck the police. Like, you know, there's a gang truce in effect between the Bloods, Crips, and Black Guerrilla family across West Baltimore.
I mean, you're talking five generations of gangs now. I just want to point out that, like, a truce is only saying that if we're not going to have drama between us because we got plenty of drama elsewhere. I mean, these are people that, they're like, you know, the Ukrainians and the Russians. That would be a good fucking example. Or the Turks and the Greeks. Like, it's not that they're at peace. It's just that they're tolerating each other more than usual,
I'm telling you, Paul, if you're in the streets, it almost is. Everybody is uniting against the police. Like, you know, east side, west side, like across gang affiliations, across ages, like white people and black people, like, as long as they're poor, I mean, everybody is coming together against the cops. Like, I saw, like, fucking guys in red bandanas and guys in blue bandanas embracing.
Did I ever tell you the story? I mean, I want to point out that Baltimore has always had that sort of unity. I mean, I want to downplay this media spectacle of gangs, because, like, gangs in Baltimore are about making money. So it's like saying rival businesses aren't blowing each other up. Like, it's not something that happens. Inter-gang warfare or violence is pretty rare, actually, in comparison to, like, intra.
Sure.
Like, when they're killing someone, it's because they were disloyal or did something wrong. But,
sure.
Or someone in their own neighborhood, you know? Like, it's not they're, like, going into another neighborhood to stir up shit. Like, it's not like the old school. But anyway, so did I tell you the story where, like, in 2007, I think it was, like, 2 or 3 months before you and I met, or it could have been after, when I knew you. And I was living, I think, in South Baltimore. Check it out. I was fucking around in this, like, construction site. And fucking, I was just fucking around. I don't even know what I was really doing. I was bored. And I remember I had this laptop computer and whatever, and I was typing on it. And I didn't have it after I ran away. Because the cops showed up, and I don't even remember what this... It was a big building. It might have been an apartment complex they were building or something. But I was running from the cops, and I slipped in the alley and landed on some broken glass, and all up and down my arm was bleeding, and I just got back up and started, and I kept running, and I got, like, probably 6 or 7 blocks east, and then I took a sharp right, and I was down this, like, alley, and then I was on the other side of the block, and this, like, old black lady, she was like, hey, come here, come inside, and she dragged me inside, and she, like, you know, some kind of garment around my arm, and it wasn't my shirt because I was still wearing my shirt, and fucking, she was like, okay, now you just chill here, and I'll let you know when they go by, because I know they're probably chasing you, right? And I was like, who? And she was like, cops. And I was like, yeah, exactly. And so, you know, like, I just want to point out that, like, people have never liked the cops there. This was just like a really good example of why, I think.
Right.
Makes sense? What, the story?
Absolutely.
Like,
yeah.
She had no reason to,
to
care for me. I think that her dislike of the police, for whatever reason, I didn't even get her name. You know, as soon as the cops had passed by, I went back the other way and home. And so, I mean, I think that's a good way to illustrate, like, what real Baltimoreans are like. They would rather take in a stranger than watch that stranger go away, you know, for
absolutely
no reason. Like, I wasn't even, like, all the worst I was doing was trespassing. You know, I wasn't, like, breaking shit or doing anything wrong.
Right.
So.
Anyway, I think how all this relates to what's been going on in Baltimore and the protests, I mean, I think there was a lot of the criticism of the protesting and rioting has really, like, missed the point, and to someone like me, who's a Baltimore native, who's lived here my whole life, and somebody like you, who, you know, who's lived in West Baltimore and experienced firsthand the aggression that people, you know, endure daily there. Like, I mean, it comes across as really tone deaf, right? Because, like, there was a great quote in The Atlantic from Ta-Nehisi Coates in a piece called Nonviolence as Compliance. That was like, a riot can't be correct or wise any more than a forest fire can be correct or wise. You know,
right.
But people are angry, and, like, that's, I think, like, people were just pushed to a breaking point, and something had to give, and
it's happened elsewhere,
fighting.
You know, and it's happened in Baltimore before, and it happens worldwide. It's just a symptom of a broken system. But I think even that kind of misses the point, which is that actually no police were killed during these so-called riots. And that's what it would take. It would take a full-scale assault on the government, like an overthrow of a foreign government, for the media, the same media, to classify it as a riot. And secondly, all of the damage that was done, every single toilet paper roll that was shoplifted that day, those days, all of that is covered by a well-regulated industry called insurance. So every bit of it, the companies will either get it back in kind,
sure,
or they will get it back plus some.
Sure.
So they actually made money on this too. So, you know, let's...
That's right.
Like, if you're sitting around crying about riots, like, show me the white people that got hurt like they did in L.A. Like,
Won't somebody think of the poor windows?
Yeah. Like, there was... You know, this isn't anything like the Rodney King riots. Like, nothing. Like, in the Rodney King riots, there's a lot more violence, and I think that's because people in L.A. are a lot fucking angrier in general. And
I think that was more of a race riot.
That was more... If you're going to talk about a race riot, there was that... I mean, I'll never forget.
This was something else. This was an uprising. This was a rebellion against the police state.
Right, and I just think that can't be overstated.
Class Baltimoreans of all colors came together,
like,
in
as much as
and
cops...
while blacks were definitely in the leadership. I actually think later. I think it's important to point out, though, that, like, in West Baltimore, like in Sandtown, like people from New York came down and were branded outside agitators, but in Sandtown, I'm almost as much of an outsider as somebody from New York, you know?
I'm
a white guy from Northeast Baltimore. Like, my side of the 28th Street Bridge was quiet as shit on Monday night. And the other side, there were helicopters, there were people in the streets, there were riot cops, you know, there were burning cars, it was, you know.
Well, I think that it needs to be said more and more that what happened in Baltimore, it wasn't as racially... I mean, like, cops like to say all the time about how it's not because he was black, you know. But at the same time, it's not because he was black to us either. Like, the white people that were on the streets, it wasn't because he was black. He could have been fucking... He could have been a politician or something. Like,
I
honestly...
I do think that, you know, police violence is definitely color-coded in this country.
Sure, and I agree. And I think
the structure of a society has been color-coded. It's been a convenient way for the ruling elite to control us for a long time.
But there's
I think that by rising up against, you know, against the state, and this fight increasingly being the people versus the state, that's, you know, how that, that history of whiteness is going to start to be erased, you know?
And well, like, the thing that's is, there is a measuring stick, you know?
It's like in the Lucasville prison rebellions, where after, you know, there was a gang truce between racialized gangs there, and they took over the prison and even executed a few guards. And after, when the media came in, after the National Guard had broken it up, the graffiti on the walls said convict unity, convict race. And I think the same thing has happened in the open-air prison that we call West Baltimore.
Well, and I agree, and I think we're wrapping up here this segment, then we'll roll into one lesser important segment, I guess, in the overall scheme of things. I think that there is a measuring stick for what they should call a riot, what should be considered a riot in America, and the Rodney King wasn't even killed, and yet there, you know, there's plenty of footage from those demonstrations where, you know, there was a white guy just driving down the street and some non-white guys decided to pull him out and beat the living hell out of him and almost kill him, and you know, and that was racially motivated, and so was the beating of Rodney King, and so was the failure to convict the cops that did it. And I mean, Baltimore, I would say, of all places, is kind of over it. Like, it's majority black, so if you're a white person living there and you're racist, you're stupid. Like, where do you base this on? Your whole entire city is run by black folks. You know, so I guess I'm just saying that if they're going to call it a riot, it needs to at least live up to that standard. But you had the difference you had here was you had white people on the streets with the black people demonstrating. So how is this, you know, because there is a lot of people saying, oh, well, they're being racist. They're saying it's all about whites versus blacks. They're trying to divide us. And like you guys that are sitting back on your fucking Facebook saying that shit are so united in the first fucking place. Give me a break.
Yeah, this is definitely about the people against the police. And the entire slogan, the slogan Black Lives Matter, is an attack on the police, too, because of the color-coded and racialized way that police push out violence in our society.
After the year,
you know, it's going to be really interesting to see how this will keep going. I mean, I want to tell a little anecdote about the day that the riots started, you know, or the Monday, or the uprising, whatever, the street fighting on Monday, when it first broke out at Mondawmin Mall. I was on the number 8 bus coming home from work, and everybody was checking their smartphones and following the news in real time, and all the high school kids on the bus who were getting off of school were really excited, and it was getting crowded, so the bus driver says what they always say, and it's like, okay, I need everybody to move to the back of the bus, please move to the back of the bus, and the front of the bus just erupted, and the high school kids were standing up and yelling at him, and like, fuck you, that's some 60s shit, those days are done, you know, and it was amazing. It was just I think it was a great example of, like, you know, kind of the unreasonable excess of a revolutionary moment that can be kind of beautiful. And the poor bus driver was just, like, throwing his arms up and saying, I'm sorry, I didn't mean it like that. But, you know, people's consciousness has really just been shaken up by this. And I think of stories about Athens and Greece, after the riots for Alexis Grigoropoulos in 2008, where it just changed the culture and the atmosphere of the city. And police would tell old women to put out their cigarettes on the subway and the old woman would just say, fuck you. And Baltimore's kind of turned into that now. Like, this past Tuesday, I was walking down the street and I saw a cop, detaining an older black man and you know, kind of like twirling his club and showing it off, and I started pretending to film it on my phone. I don't even have a camera on my phone. I have an ancient prehistoric, you know, dumb phone, but I started pretending to film him, and I was like, officer, you're being filmed. And he was like, fine, film me all you want, put a fucking body camera on me, why don't you? And like, so, and he got in his car and drove away and left. And me and the guy laughed about it. So it's really just, you know, there was a great, you know, twist on the old theme I heard from an elderly man at the bus stop the other day who said, you know, I have nothing against the police as individuals. They're people just like you and me. I have police officers in my family. The only thing is, man, they're the enemy. And I love it, you know. People are really starting to.
That boat has sailed for police in this country, for sure. That boat has definitely sailed. I mean, our lives have seen, just your and I's short lives. We're both under 30. We've seen enough proof, like proof, factual proof, that they not only don't protect and serve us, but they're not good at their job anyway. I mean, they're not even good at keeping us in line. They're not good at, I mean, it would be nice if you're going to have this humongous overfunded police force. It would be nice to see less fucking child molesters on the streets. You know, wouldn't that be a fucking beautiful thing? Just saying, like, sure. if you're gonna have this, all this, it'd be cool if there's a positive effect of it now and then. But there's not. Because those things that scare people the most are the things they want to exist the most, because it justifies their existence the most. So.
Yeah, a society gets the criminals it deserves. Absolutely.
Right. Yeah, well, I mean, fuck, a society that has leisure gets what it deserves.
Absolutely.
But, so, now more...
Yeah, the only thing I looted all riot long was the, all protest long was the 99-cent Arizona iced tea. You know, so, if they ever catch me, I guess I'll have to pay for that.
Shit, I used to shoplift those every day anyway in San Francisco. No lie, I did that at least 10 times.
Blasting.
This was like at the tail end of Occupy San Francisco, which was the last Occupy to die, I would say. And the way they died was the fucking police would make a deal with a tweaker from anywhere in the city that if he didn't want to even go to jail, they would just drop him off at Occupy and say, you have to stay here, if, you know, indefinitely. This is where you're gonna fucking be homeless now, is at Occupy. And, you know, they're, so we got this, like, we had this, like, overwhelming majority of tweakers at the end, like, to the point where even I didn't give a shit when they got shut down. I was like, whatever, it's a fucking festering meth hole, you know, like, I was across the street, like, watching. Like, there was, like, 12 tweakers just left. And like 50 sleeping bags. They were greedy little fucks too. They wouldn't even share a blanket with me like two nights before that. Anyway, so the NSA, I mean, so fuck, dude. They literally just got their asses handed to them in federal court. Did you kind of think that was possible?
No, I didn't. But I also don't really
think they give a shit about breaking the law. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, who's going to enforce this on them?
Well, I mean, it starts there, and then obviously, I guess you and I now have civil suits against them if they've ever, you know, I sent in the request form. They have it on the NSA.gov. You can send in a form to request whatever data they've collected on you, and they sent me back. I have it somewhere in this office, and I guess on the next episode I'll recite portions of it, but it basically says, I hope in the future we have more time to just be more chill and whatever, but this is a really important thing to talk about. But, so basically they just make up all this bullshit about, yeah, we're supposed to give it to you, but we don't have to because of this. So it's something like, as long as we don't acknowledge that we have anything on you, then we don't have to give anything we do have, or something like that. It was really convoluted. Like, it made zero sense, but it was 4 pages long. And it was deeply upsetting to me because I want to leave the country eventually, and I was hoping to find out what may or may not stop me from getting citizenship in a more reasonable country, like, I don't know, Uganda. No, I guess I'd take Norway or Iceland or something.
Where is
someplace, yeah, like
Iceland
that.
Would be awesome.
Yeah, Iceland is badass. They put the bankers in jail.
Yeah, they overthrew their own government in 2009. And a kitchenware revolution.
And it wasn't a riot.
No, it wasn't. It was a simple protest. And although they tore all of the furniture out of Parliament, burned it in the streets, it was a peaceful demonstration. Thank you very much.
At least according to
this. Characterized that. Yeah.
CNN, yeah.
Uh-huh.
So, signing off for holyfuck.ninja, holyfuckwebnews, holyfuck.ninja, Isaac. I'm Paul.
And I'm Isaac.
And fuck the government, fuck the police.
Police. Got a badge, you bitch.
Fuck the police. Come search this bitch, cause I don't do weight, cause I'm too straight, and y'all little bitches a little too late. Cuff me up and throw my feet, I look them all in their face. Walk me out like I'm a killer, scared to fuck out my name. Pen and paper on the table and told me, give us a man so you can lead his bitch. I can't believe this bitch. What in the hell? Opened the pound and counted out 700. So much shit ain't get found. And I know the police listening. I'm telling you now, you can never hold a trigger.
We'll be coming to you the 1st and 15th of every month and hereafter. Thank you so much for tuning in. If you want to support us, look to the show notes or the show site at holyfuck.ninja.